A very hearty welcome to this CAFRAL webinar, which is the third in the series in the COVID times, which we have hosted. The third one we are hosting right now. This is about RBI draft guidelines on securitization. Actually, if you see the draft guidelines, it has got two building blocks. The other one is on sale of loan exposures. For that, we're going to have one more on 30th. So all those participants who are here may note they can register for that one also. So we did one on credit risk assessment in post-COVID times. Then we did another one, framework for the assessment of financial crime and terrorist financing risk. And this is the third one. I'm very happy to welcome the distinguished panelists. The discussion will be led by Dr. Harshvardhan, the senior advisor, Bain & Co. He was the chairperson of the committee on the development of housing finance securitization market. Thank you very much, Dr. Harshvardhan, for being with us today. We are also with us, Mr. Chandan Sinha, with the interim director of CAFRAL, who was one of the members of the committee on the development of housing finance securitization market. We have also with us Prasanna Balachandra, with the head global markets ICICI Bank. And we have the fourth panelist, Prasanna Balachandra, head global markets, chief legal counsel, Northern Arc Capital. Thank you very much. Mr. Prasanna, welcome on board. I will request Mr. Sinha to initiate the conversation. Thank you. Over to you, Mr. Sinha.
Of course, a pleasure to be, part of this webinar. Of course, I'll just take a few minutes and give you a brief background or the thinking which was there with, the committee when it was doing its report. Of course, beyond that, it's all Dr. Harsh, who is, really the person behind the report. So essentially, this report is about developing a mortgage-based mortgage market in India, a PTC market as opposed to a DA market, which we have, which is somewhat more, far more thriving than the PTC market in respect of mortgages. Of course, the committee had a benefit of, interacting with a wide range of, market participants and including other players, other experts from, say, taxation, legal, accounting, because, these are the pillars on which, any product is built. So we did all that. But of course, and we, of course, think we've covered most of it, but surely there would be some other elements which are missed out, or people like you may have some different view. You're most welcome to kind of, air them today or subsequently or directly with the Reserve Bank of India. So I think a couple of, the fundamental reason, I think, for the committee to be there is, of course, there's a couple of fundamental reasons. And of course, there was an immediate trigger because of which I think the RBI thought, that this committee should come into play. First, of course, the fundamental reason is we have a very ambitious Housing for All program, which would require a huge, funding over the next few years. That's being estimated to be, 100 lakh to 100 lakh, 115 lakh crores, The current housing market, as mentioned in the report, is only about 20 lakh crores. So that's a huge funding. And of course, you need, all engines to work. And this is, of course, one of them. The financing by banks and HFCs are, of course, they are the main players in this particular market. But all of them run an ALM mismatch. In case of, banks, it gets a little better managed because they have deposits, which, you tend to, you generally grow your deposits. You don't really tend to lose them except, occasionally or under very extreme circumstances. But the point remains that you run an ALM mismatch. But the reason, the more immediate trigger for, probably this committee, though, of course, we've had committees on mortgage thing way back in 2000, early 2000, there was a committee. So they had also looked into these issues. But I guess over a period of time and post GFC and the changes which were made, this was the right time to make a revisit. And probably the COVID-19 has reinforced that, because again, you have, in a sense, some stress on liquidity. And whenever there is a stress on liquidity, you'd like to, monetize your assets. And if there was a market for it, it actually becomes much simpler. Of course, there are other ways of doing it, but far more tedious and far more time taking. So actually, you could actually run into a solvency issue, much quicker, if your liquidity thing is not solved very quickly. So probably that would have been one of the motivations for that. A thriving mortgage, this thing certainly would help. PTC market would have helped in mitigating the stress of these kinds, far more flexibly and perhaps quickly. as I mentioned, we've had a far more thriving DA market, which is more of a bilateral, non-transparent market between a bank and mostly an HFC. Or it could be an MFI, or it could be an NBFC, depending on, it's beyond mortgages. So it could be cover other kinds of assets as well. But the whole issue when we were looking at it, as I said, we were looking only on the MBS market, and a short-term fix could have been, as a thought process which was there, is there a way we kind of shift, from the DA to the PTC, and that in a sense, meets some of the objectives, for which, the committee had been set up. So one could be by, simply incentivizing the players in some form, or incentivizing PTCs in general, and specifically over the MBS, so as to actually have traction in this particular market. But of course, the committee didn't take that particular view, and rightly so, and they had a much more longer term view about how to develop the market. And then if you get into, this longer term issue, then a host of issues actually come up. And basically, I think we followed a two-pillar approach, is how can we improve efficiency and how we could improve the transparency. I think in this particular two-pillar approach, probably if you kind of, fix it, and under these heads, we probably looked at, what was the role for the different players. So for efficiency, of course, you need to have, you have to tweak the regulations. There's an issue with accounting, there's a, issue with taxation, and of course, there's a legal issue also which needs to be resolved, because these actually impose transaction costs on the kind of, product which you are going to do. And unless they are sorted out, it can actually become very tedious or far more costly, so that there is no incentive to actually go and do it. And on the transparency side, of course, as a country, I think we generally lack data. So unless there is sufficient data available on what's going on and what kind of mortgages and what's their history, what's their, delinquency rate, what's their, repayment rates, host of issues, you need full data for somebody in the market to take a call. And at the same time, for any market product to, come into being, you need to have standardization. So the start has to be in some form of a standardization of the loan and its processes, because whoever buys a particular loan is sure of, having that the loan is actually met certain standards, and therefore what is buying is uniform irrespective of from whom and when he has acquired it. So this is broadly the concept of conforming loans, which is there in more developed markets. So you need to have some kind of, process, both for standardizing it and in the process itself. And finally, you need also to have some kind of a market structure. So you can actually have the product, but you also need a market infrastructure. And the market infrastructure also at times probably needs a developmental institution to kind of foster the product or, enable its, wide acceptance, mainly not so much through, kind of, financial support, but, for example, just disseminating the data itself, which is it is there, and without taking too much of a balance sheet risk, and at the same time, the role of a market maker. So some of these elements is easy to understand if you look from the corporate bond market. So we talked about the corporate bond market also for a very long time, and you know, these are some of the fixes when you need, when you bring a product like that. Also, I think, you know, somewhere the group did take a view that, you know, MBS in some form, a PTC would become like a corporate bond. You know, there's an underlying asset, and of course it's a far superior product, and therefore it should also enjoy the benefits which are available to a corporate bond, like repos and things like that. So of course that will be elaborated separately. So I would say, so these were, you know, some of the thinking which was there. And then a two-pillar approach, we did focus on efficiency and transparency, and then looked at it from the perspective of the originator, the investor, and the enabling infrastructure which is there. So each of these elements, you know, so what would, you know, for an originator would work from a regulatory side and accounting side, taxation or legal side, similarly for the investors. And having all this in place, what are the other enablers or a developmental function which would require to, you know, see that the product starts, you know, actually flowing. So I'll stop there. There are a few other elements that, you know, which did come up as part of the crisis, that we also need to have a standardization of the servicing arrangements, because when we did have a crisis, we find that, you know, the servicing of the loans was actually being done by the entity itself, like a housing finance company. And when it's in trouble, that actually breaks down. So you actually need a separate servicing agent, which, you know, irrespective of who takes over that particular loan, is assured of that particular service. So those are some of the other hygiene, you know, factors which also came into the play. So as I said, you know, so it's important, you know, it actually, so, and our recommendations actually of the group actually are at various levels, including Reserve Bank. Some are directed at the government, some SEBI, some could be IDA, some of course the NHB has to do it. But we are hopeful that the Reserve Bank of India will pilot the changes that are required for the ecosystem to come in place, and for us to finally have a thriving market, mortgage backed securities market. So I'll stop here, and I would request Mr. Harsh to, you know, take it forward with, you know, of course, his views and his recommendations. Thank you.
Thank you, Sinha sir, and welcome everyone to this webinar. Mr. Sinha has already covered most of the contextual details of how the committee came about and how it really broadly thought about the issue. I'll just reiterate one fact that the committee's mandate was clearly to focus on securitization for mortgages for housing finance, whereas the guidelines that have come out cover a broader range of types of securitization. So that's just something you have to keep in mind. And there's just one more point that I'll add to the context. As I said, Sinha has covered all of it. And that point is that if you take a macro perspective, if you look at the whole architecture of our financial system, we have two ways credit is provided. Either it goes through institutions like banks or NBFCs, or it goes through markets, through bond markets and mutual funds and so on. And by and large, these two platforms, these two systems were independent, meaning there was hardly any exchange between them. The one way to connect these two, to establish a pipe between them, is securitization. So for example, one of the, Mr. Sinha talked about a large amount of money that we need to come into housing in order to support our housing for all kind of ambitions. One other thing that needs to happen is that a longer term capital, debt capital pool, therefore come in. And those are available with people like insurers and pension funds. And today they are severely constrained because they can't make loans. So they can't participate in a DA type of transaction. However, if you had a thriving mortgage backed securitization market, then those capital pools can start coming. And so this, I always view securitization as a cord, as a link between what I call intermediated credit markets, which operates through institutions, versus disintermediated credit market, which operates through bond markets and funds and so on. So that's something I think we should keep at the back of our mind when we look at why this transaction is important from a broader financial system architecture point of view. With that, as Mr. Sinha said, the committee securitization primarily used two lenses to look at the issue. One was of efficiency, the other was of transparency, because both of these are very critical, we believed, in order to create a thriving securitization market. Efficiency basically means you try to minimize the transaction cost. There are all manners of transaction cost in a securitization transaction, whether they arise because of issues, taxation issues, stamp duties, and this and that. Some of them also create uncertainty because in many areas the laws are not very clear. And so a lot of our recommendations were motivated by this to drive efficiency in the underlying transaction so that it becomes a low cost, at least low transaction cost affair for all the participants, and therefore become that much more attractive. The other part was transparency. There is an underlying risk in any credit product. So is the case with securitization. And so the more transparent you make it, the more transparent all aspects, the clearer everybody has the understanding of the underlying risk, and therefore the pricing becomes sharper and the market becomes that much more robust. So those are the two things we kept in mind while looking at the issue. If I go to our recommendation, we had in all 31 recommendations, of which 16 were for RBI, roughly a half. And then there were some for central and state governments, those related to stamp duty and registration and so on. There were some related to the other regulators, such as SEBI, IRDA, PFRDA, primarily focused around encouraging entities under their own jurisdiction to start investing into securitized paper. There were four for NHB, National Housing Bank. Sinha talked about that. Just as a note of information that when the committee was working, when we started the regulation of HFCs was with NHB, halfway through the work of the committee towards the end, it was moved to RBI. So that's what happened during the deliberations of the committee. And we had also some recommendation for the tax administration because there are a number of taxation issues. And as Mr. Sinha mentioned, the overarching theme there was that securitized paper is to bond, and therefore the treatment as paper from a tax sense should be as close to that for a bond as possible. So those were, as you all know, have come from the RBI. And therefore, obviously, they can be respond to or address the recommendation that were made for RBI. Of the 16 recommendation we made for RBI, roughly, I would say half each were related to the transaction per se, and the other half were related to what happens post the transaction. Let me explain what I mean by that. The number of recommendations, for example, those related to minimum holding period or minimum retention ratio, these are transaction related issues, which means these issues arise when the transaction of securitization takes place. And then there are a host of recommendations, as Mr. Sinha referred to, about allowing repurchase agreements, allowing credit default swaps, allowing securitized mortgage-backed paper to be included in HTM. Those happen later on. These are not issues related to underlying transaction. They arise after the transaction is over. So roughly, as I said, half, 7 or 8 of these recommendations related to the transaction. And I must say most of them have been included in the guidelines. The three most important were, actually four most important were, one, to treat DA and PTCs as separately. DA, direct assignments, is in the nature of loan sale and now has been appropriately included in the second set of guidelines, which are the guidelines that relate to secondary market for loans. For the 2006 guideline, they were put together as securitization, and that's why all our data that we get in the past, which is called securitization, you will find a large majority of those transactions are actually DA transactions, which by any sort of widely accepted definition of securitization would not be called as securitization. So one recommendation was that you should treat them separately so that you can make specific regulations for PTC type of securitization, which is the real securitization. So that was first recommendation. And the three other, which were relating to transaction, which were very important ones, were those related to the minimum holding period, the minimum retention ratio, and the credit resets, which our recommendations were for mortgage backed securitization. And those have all been accommodated in the new guidelines. And in fact, the guidelines clearly says that there is a carve out for mortgage backed securities compared to other types of securitization because of the unique nature of that asset class. And these three important guidelines have been included in the proposed guidelines. The fourth area where the issued guidelines actually are very elaborate, where the committee had made a recommendation, was those relating to adoption of the Basel III capital standards. Basel III committee had very, very detailed guidelines on how to compute regulatory capital requirement for securitized paper, people who invest in them. And what our committee has said, that we had actually reviewed that very carefully. And our conclusion was that it is, it's a fairly sophisticated and what we call informationally intense approach, which means it requires a lot of information for the actual capital to be computed. And so we had suggested that the RBI should conduct a separate exercise on actually assessing its impact as to how much it will change capital levels, because our current guidelines are fairly conservative. And after that, RBI should determine whether we should adopt them. And it is clear from the new guidelines that they want to go in that direction. Broadly speaking, the new guidelines, I must say, take us much closer to the Basel III framework of securitization, and adopts most of its prescriptions. The set of guidelines that were not one of recommendation was at the time of initiation of the securitization transaction was that was the one related to assigned. So the earlier guidelines said, if, for example, one to put it very simply, if one company, one bank buys a pool of assets from another entity, HFC, that pool will not be permitted to be securitized further. And our recommendation was that if the underlying pool satisfies all the requirements for securitization, then there is no reason why it should not be permitted, because all that has happened before is that the pool has been sold. And I think, again, that recommendation has been accepted, that, you know, assigned pool or already transferred sold pool can be further securitized. As I said, there were other recommendations, 7 to 8, which related to the post securitization transaction issues related to classification of asset-backed securities into a particular investment bucket, to repurchase transaction, to credit default swaps, also listing requirements, so on and so forth. Those have not been announced, and that's that is to be expected, because they probably do not come under banking regulation. They probably come under financial market operations part of the RBI. And therefore, you might expect later on a separate set of guidelines. So that was our recommendation, and how that those recommendations have been incorporated in the guidelines. Let me quickly give you a 5 minutes overview of the guidelines. And this is not meant to provide great level of detail, just to give an overview, because then the other participants that we have on this panel could add specific commercial and market aspects of this. The first one, I would say that this is a very detailed and elaborate framework, largely following the Basel III recommendation. Compared to the previous set of guidelines, there were three sets which we had in the past, 2006, 2012, and 2013. This set of guidelines are much more detailed. And if I may dare say, they are much more sophisticated in the way that they look at the underlying transaction. Secondly, it has a broader coverage, as I said at the beginning, that it does not only deal with the mortgage-backed securitization, but it covers a broad gamut of other types of securitization. Very importantly, it allows for a single asset securitization. And that's again important, because so far what we have seen in the country, and I must say even globally, the securitization business is dominated by pooled asset securitization. And by pooled assets, I mean you take 5,000 home loans and create a pool and then sell that pool. That's the kind of transaction that's common. Single asset means that there could be a single loan that is made by an entity which can potentially be securitized. So imagine a large. Hello. Let's say there is a 1,000 crore or 2,000 crore power loan that a bank has. The bank can actually convert that loan into tradable securities by through securitization, as long as the transaction follows all the guidelines that have been prescribed. So that's been a major advance. The other issue is that there is a revolving structure that's now possible. And while and you have to distinguish between revolving credit and revolving structure. Revolving credit means underlying loans that are of revolving nature, like cash credit and so on, those are still not permitted. They were earlier even not permitted. But what is permitted is a structure where you can keep replenishing the assets. and some of the market participants, some of the other participants could throw a light on how that construct would work in practically in the marketplace. So those are some of the new area that have, so to say, been added into these guidelines. The guidelines also provide very detailed detailed prescriptions for various parties in the transaction. So for example, how do you create a special purpose entity, the trust in between, which actually is central to the construct of a securitization. What are the obligations on that trust? What are the obligations on the transaction between the trust and the originator? So all those detailed guidelines have been provided. So also on the originator, on the liquidity providers, these intermediaries, the special purpose entities, often require liquidity support to deal with short-term mismatches in cash flow. So what are the obligations of people who will provide liquidity to that entity, to the servicers, to the credit enhancers? So all the participants in the broader securitization transaction, detailed instructions have been provided to them, which in the earlier guidelines weren't there. And the third most important thing is that the approach to capital calculation is much more sophisticated, and it basically does broad approaches: the standardized approach, which is mandatory for the external rating based approach, which is mandatory for NBFCs and HFCs, and a standardized approach. And in within each of these two approaches, there is a subcategory of something called STC, simple, transparent, and comparable transaction, which Basel talks about. For which there is another separate treatment that has been provided. Broadly speaking, STC transactions would attract lower capital than non-STC transaction. And the way to think about it is that an STC transaction is a transaction where the underlying asset pool is a very well-known, standardized, very commonly done for the former. You can understand is a far more standardized and commonly understood and commonly dealt with sort of a loan pool, which will find it much easier to qualify as STC than the latter, which is 10 customized infrastructure loans. And so the idea is that in an STC transaction, the underlying risk is much clearer to all the participants, and hence it attracts slightly lower capital requirements on all parts. So the capital approach in the new guidelines is far more sophisticated. It also raises some issues. It creates very high risk weight for 1250%, which is basically the entire tranche is treated as equity for transactions that don't fall within the securitization framework. It also probably increases the capital requirement for second loss tranches. And so those are some of the issues that we would see how they evolve in the marketplace going forward. And also some of those issues may get refined as we develop more greater comfort on the underlying transactions and more transactions take place. So I almost see some parts of these guidelines as a work in process, which will continuously be refined as more and more transactions happen. And the last thing about the new transaction is that there are a lot more disclosure requirements that have been prescribed. Principle of transparency. One way to achieve transparency in any transaction is through disclosures. And therefore, these guidelines actually mandate a lot more disclosure and lot more formal disclosures than was the case in the previous guidelines. And which is, I think, good. It goes a long way to make this transaction much more transparent. So given these high level differences or high level features of the guidelines, I would talk briefly about what I think are the likely implications of these guidelines, which means how do you see the business evolving? You have to keep in mind that there are other stakeholders, such as the ones we talked about, the central and state government, stamp duty law, tax law, taxation related laws. I think there has to be movement on those fronts as well in order to encourage these transactions, because just by RBI moving, we are not going to get a fully developed environment or fully developed field for securitizations. And I hope that once the RBI has moved, the other stakeholders also would move. So that's one thing to keep in mind. There is as an example of that, one guideline says that the special purpose entity has to be bankruptcy remote. which means in the event of a bankruptcy of the originator, the assets that are sold to the special purpose entity remain outside of the liquidation estate of the originator. Now, that is not something RBI can regulate on. It has to be a part of the bankruptcy law. We don't have a bankruptcy law right now for financial institutions. So whenever such a law is written, this has to be provided in for that law, because until that time, there will be, I guess, some level of uncertainty around the bankruptcy remoteness of this intermediary vehicle. Second, I feel that all the participants will take some time to understand, given that some of these requirements, especially those related to capital, are slightly more complicated. They will take some time to digest and understand. That is to be expected. However, the current liquidity squeeze, especially for NBFCs and NBFC, may encourage and push some of the players to pursue these transactions more aggressively. Also, other financial sector regulators have to also probably make some changes and at least encourage entities they regulate, insurance and pension funds, to start looking at securitized paper. I mean, today, for example, I strongly believe in falling interest rate markets. For an insurer or a pension fund, a mortgage-backed paper could easily give anywhere between, you know, 70, 80 to 150 basis point higher yield than a comparable AAA rated paper. And so this is, and also of a longer maturity. And so this is something which could be very attractive for some of these long-term investors like pension and mutual fund. But their regulators should take steps that we had also recommended in our report to encourage that. Single asset securitization, to my mind, is a very, very important, interesting new development. It could help a lot of large infrastructure assets, which are standard assets, which are performing well, but are straining banks on either the ALM issues or just liquidity issues, to be securitized. In the long run, this can emerge as a very interesting alternative to loan syndication. So far in India, if you had to provide debt finance to a large infra type of project, let's say 20-30,000 crore kind of loan, then the only way to do that right now is to syndicate that loan across banks. Now you can actually first originate the loan and then securitize it, and through that distribute that loan to other people. So it's a very interesting development. We'll have to see how that catches on. There are other broader institutional developments that have to take place. So, for example, we need to have more set of people providing credit enhancement. Today, it has basically been only originator which provided the first loss, and then typically NBFCs and bank which provide second loss. We need to get more diverse set of people coming into this. And I think with these guidelines making clear the underlying conditions, I hope that these new institutions develop. Mr. Sinha talked about servicing risk and servicer. We, in most developed securitized markets like the US and Europe, some parts of Europe, there are third-party servicers, which are like BPO operators who can do third-party servicing of loan pools. So even if the originator goes bankrupt or ceases to exist, there is a credible entity that can service those loans. We need to have such kind of entities develop in India in order to take away that servicer risk. It is kind of weighs in on the transaction, increases costs for everybody and so on. So my final point, broadly speaking, I think these guidelines are very positive. They are very modern. They are sophisticated. As a result, they are a little bit complicated, but I think they are exactly in the right direction. Once I think all the participants understood it, and especially the other stakeholders also move, then I see they can actually promote the securitization market, which will be in the broader interest of our financial architecture, and create a reliable new source of financing for many asset classes. Let me stop there, and I probably would now, Mr. Panda, hand over to one of the panelists, maybe Mr. Prasanna first.
Yes, please, Mr. Prasanna can take over from here.
Thanks, Mr. Panda, and thanks, Mr. Harshvardhan, and thanks to Mr. Sinha also. So I wanted to actually start off by saying I'm feeling like kind of an odd person in this panel, because I'm heading treasury and I'm a kind of a generalist. We do everything, we don't master anything. But on the other hand, we have three other persons in the panel who have actually mastered the art of getting into securitization in detail. So I'm really, honored to be in this panel. I mean, the advantage of being a generalist and not being an expert in the field is you can possibly ask more questions and give answers. So that's, I think, the advantage. So I would possibly, when it comes to it, raise some pertinent issues here and hope and expect that some of the answers would be given by Dr. Harshvardhan, who's actually chaired the committee, and maybe Mr. Chandan Sinha as well. So let me just start off by also pointing out two or three things which Mr. Sinha spoke and Dr. Harshvardhan spoke, which really touched my heart, which is the point about the setting the pipe clear between the corporate bond market and the MBS market. And the other way to look at it is the pipe, setting up the pipe between the retail market, who has the retail market, and the institutional market, which has the funds. So actually, the whole purpose of securitization, I would say, is this ability to redistribute the credit risk and strip it out of the originator. So if you really look at it, the originators and investors really have different skill sets and different abilities. So the originators have the ability to source the credit risk, but they don't necessarily have the ability to hold the credit risk beyond a particular point. While on the other hand, investors have the money, but they might not have the ability to keep sourcing it as much as they have the money. So the point about mutual funds and insurance companies and maybe foreign portfolio investors, which also I'll touch upon a little bit later, all have the money, but they don't necessarily have the ability to source like the way a bank can source. And so it is very, very appropriate that securitization is really talked about in this kind of a framework, where we really look at it as bridging this gap between the people who have the money and people who are able to source credit risk. So if you really go back 10 years or 20 or 12 years, the global financial crisis really taught us about the pitfalls of complicated structures which involve securitizations like CDOs and CDO squares. It taught us the pitfalls. But at the same time, it is very, very important to note that simple structures really help in deleveraging the originators and, like I said, bridging the gap between the haves and the have-nots as far as money is concerned. So there is a very, very important role that securitization performs. So I'm very happy to note that the Reserve Bank has taken this into cognizance, has come out with this draft guidelines into, you know, kind of push the product much more into the future and get it more active. Now, in terms of how the characteristics of the securitization market has been in India so far, like I think Chandan Sinha did mention, it's more of a DA market than a PTC market. It was around 75%, 25% gap in the previous years. But what I hear often is that there are more and more PTCs which are being structured, and we are more in the 60 to 40% kind of a split. However, within PTCs, I would say that it is predominantly the PSLC, the priority sector lending certificates, that are acting as the major impetus for development of this PTC market. There have been a few corporates who have tapped the securitization markets to raise funds under the non-PSL route as well, but it has not really been significant as much as the PSL market. The other point to note is that there has hardly been any secondary market volumes to be to note in PTCs so far. So it's predominantly be primarily a hold kind of a market. So people who have money for longish period come and pick up PTC from people who are originating it, and the originators then free up their capital and then go and securitize fresh originate fresh assets. And it's like the equivalent of buying a bond and selling it. So I think that's the role that it's been performing. But yes, like Dr. Harshvardhan said, we need to encourage the investing community a lot more and encourage in such a way, provide incentives in such a way that a lot more trading happens. I think Mr. Chandan Sinha also made the point about trading of PTCs, like how corporate bonds are trading, maybe get PTCs to be a part of the repo market. So all those things are really good thoughts, and very happy that we are discussing all of that. In terms of the market volumes, I think FY19 was really a watershed year, because that was the year when volumes really doubled in the retail securitization market. And the predominant reasons why it happened was there was a few clarifications on GST that it does at the securitized assets do not attract GST. There was also a rush from non-banks like HFCs and NBFCs rushing to securitize receivables after their resource mobilization came under pressure post the credit crisis came and hit the market. So also helping the tremendous growth in the securitization market so far was the RBI notification, which relaxed guidelines on the minimum holding period requirement. They reduced it from 12 months to 6 months, of course, with a sunset clause, which I think has been made now maybe permanent after the safe experience that we have seen in MBS. So these are the reasons that FY19 was a watershed year. Now, the interesting thing is FY20 actually saw a growth over and above FY19, even though FY19 itself was a doubling in terms of securitization. So I think this is the broad backdrop of the securitization as we speak. And so it is it's something that is very, very important, and we need to nurture this market. So in this context, now let me get into the draft guidelines, which is what has been given to me as an assignment that I should look at, possible feedback that we can discuss, and then, you know, take it forward from there. So the way I will do it is I will try and identify a few big picture point areas in the guidelines. So like I said, I'm really not an expert in this, and I have used a lot of borrowed knowledge from my retail product team. I mean, Seema Iyer and Srikanta, who's a part of my team, are there logged in as an audience in this panel and in this, this webinar. And I would be relying on them as well to, you know, come out with some points later on. But before that, I wanted to, you know, identify a few major big picture points before I get onto the nitty-gritty. So the first big point that I wanted to talk about is on the aspect of securitization and the way it has been defined. So let me just read out the exact words that the guidelines has used, and I will bring out a point which I feel might hinder the development of this market. So securitization means the set of transactions or scheme wherein credit risk associated with eligible exposures is tranched, and where payments in the set of transactions or scheme depend upon the performance of the specified underlying exposures as opposed to being derived from an obligation to the originator. And the subordination of tranches determines the distribution of losses during the life of the set of the transactions or scheme. Now, so this is how the securitization guideline defines securitization. In India, all of you will be aware, all the participants will be aware, securitization transactions are relatively plain vanilla. They are homogeneous and single tranche. They don't have multiple tranches. I think at least most of the transactions don't have multiple tranches. Our markets have still not been mature enough to have junior tranches and mezzanine tranches due to limitations on credit risk appetite, as well as regulation so far not really allowing a lot of investors to take junior tranches. So the definition that I read out above, I feel that will make a lot of securitization transactions that happened today seem to be ineligible to be classified as securitization under this definition. And the problem is that if a bank invests, now I'm looking at a bank as an investor in these transactions, they invest in this transaction, then they will be termed as in violation of this guidelines, and then the risk weight will go up to 1,250%, which was actually mentioned by Dr. Harshvardhan in some other point. Now, so this is the risk from an investor perspective. Now, I'm sure this might not have been the intention of the regulator. If it was not the intention, then it is better that the draft guideline is, you know, corrected when it is made final guidelines in terms of the final implication for the investor. So the final guidelines needs to, you know, kind of clarify about the fact that the definition of securitization will also include single tranche transactions. The second big point that I wanted to make about as far as single tranche transactions are concerned is the one which I think Dr. Harshvardhan touched upon at length, which is that this single asset securitization has been made possible in this guideline. So so this is really good news. And so basically the market for securitization has evolved so far, I would say mainly from retail loan securitizations and not really corporate loans. And the reason for this is homogeneity criteria, as he himself said that each infrastructure loan will have different covenants and different collaterals, whereas a mortgage-backed security, a retail loan would have a homogeneous character. So single asset securitization has been allowed, which is very, very good. And the advantage that this does to the investing community would be that you can actually securitize a loan given by a bank and convert it to a PTC and then sell this PTC to a foreign portfolio investor who is actually not allowed to lend. And all of you know that today we require foreign portfolio investors money coming in at all points of time, not only from a general country perspective, but also from the perspective of very limited credit appetite, which is credit risk appetite, which is residing within the country. So unfortunately, the definition of securitization, if it were to mean that single tranching is not allowed, then a single asset categorization which tries to sell it to a single investor also will possibly not be allowed as securitization. So possibly these two clarifications are required. The third point is of course related to the legal language and related to the fact that securitization and the trustees involved in the SPVs are not really a part of what is applicable for the SARFAESI Act. The SARFAESI Act actually enables the banks and financial institutions to improve the credit recovery by empowering them to enforce the security interest without intervention of the courts. These rights are also actually available for asset reconstruction companies, NPAs. But the same rights, ironically, are not available for securitization trust or their trustees, which are created for securitization of standard assets. So this clearly is a lacuna in the SARFAESI Act. I don't think RBI can do much about this, but I think the government will need to amend the SARFAESI Act to include securitization and securitization trust as a part of what is being eligible for enforcement under the SARFAESI Act. So that is the third point. The fourth point is again relating to the bankruptcy remoteness of the credit enhancement. Again, something which Dr. Harshvardhan touched upon. So the point I would like to make is, see, at the origination level, and as per the current market practice, the security for the underlying asset pool is created in the name of the originator. And in the case of bankruptcy of the originator, the credit enhancement provided by the originator also ends up being a part of the liquidation estate of the originator. So it kind of, you know, makes it devoid of bankruptcy remoteness. So I think the law for resolving the bankruptcy of the financial firms must ensure that the assets which are underlying a securitization transaction, as well as any exposures in the form of credit enhancement, whether it's in the form of deposits or any other cash collaterals, should be bankruptcy remote and not be a part of the firm's liquidation or the resolution process under the law. The last big picture point which I wanted to talk about is on the concept of the simple, transparent, and comparable transactions, the STC that was referred to. This is a very, very progressive concept for the Indian market. And any exposures to securitization that are compliant, which are classified, eligible to be classified as STC, are actually subject to lower capital requirements. So this is a welcome addition, and it's based on the prescription of the BCBS guidelines. The draft framework prescribes clearly defined criteria for categorizing the transactions as STC. But the traditional securitization that we have been doing needs to satisfy all of the additional criteria that has been laid down within the scope of this framework. And according to a preliminary analysis by us, it looks like the Indian market might not be ready for classifying all of this as STC. Because of a lot of reasons. It may be too premature to classify security transactions as securitization transactions as fulfilling STC criteria, and it might need to be adapted to the Indian context in view of specific requirement that a lot of due diligence of the underlying pool needs to be done in order to get compliance under the STC criteria. And so it's going to be very, very difficult to do that. And banks may end up actually simply relying on representations and warranties of the originators to satisfy the STC criteria, but this may not be in the best interest of the market. So our suggestion is to implement STC in a phased manner so that the market over a period of time gets time to adjust to this particular method. So there is a lot of benefit by virtue of lower capital, but at the same time, I think we need to implement it over a timely manner. So I will possibly stop here. I do have some answers to the five specific questions that have been region the draft guideline, but I have already, I think, crossed my 10 to 12 minute limit, time limit. So maybe if there is time permitting, the moderator can come back to me and I can bring up the points relating to the specific questions.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Prasanna ji. Can we now turn to Saurabh Jayanth? But before he does that, just making a quick reference to what Mr. Prasanna mentioned, and also one of the participants have flagged this issue. Possibly he can take it on board when he is speaking. The issue is credit enhancement generally are in the form of FDs, and they're in the name of the originator. Thus, they're not bankruptcy remote. As for example, the FDs placed by DHFL, you know, as credit enhancement, you know, it's being found very difficult to use them under the NCLT. So need to make some changes in the guidelines because of that, or what is the comment? So as he speaks, he can mention about
Mr. Panda, this is Harsh. Can I make a point quickly?
Yes, yes.
To make a broader point on general remoteness issue, I was deeply involved in the drafting of the IBC law. So I have some background on this issue as to what makes something bankruptcy remote or not. So I'll love to make a couple of comments.
Okay. Okay. Over to you, Arup.
Thanks, Pramod. Firstly, of course, I'd like to thank Mr. Sinha for hosting this program, and Dr. Harshvardhan for, of course, creating the subject matter which we are actually discussing. And it's obviously something that for us at Northern Arc has been very important, because unlike I think any other, most of our work revolves around securitization, and really this is one of the most important sorts of or that kind of govern what we do. So it's actually quite enough for us to kind of be here and for me to kind of speak about it. And I think Prasanna has given a very interesting commercial context, and I think banks in particular are for us an investor class, even though of course they can act as originators as well, but it's an interesting context simply because very simply, he spoke about how most of securitization he sees is single tranche, but we rarely see a single tranche transaction. And even though we do a lot of transactions in terms of, for instance, number of transactions in 1 year, like 45% of the rated transactions, and all of them were multi-tranche. Why it's multi-tranche and why we are involved in multi-tranche is simply because we invest in the mezzanine tranche in most of those cases, and the junior tranche is normally considered the first loss which is provided. So I think I'll move to some of the more technical aspects, simply because I think everyone else has already given a very good overview of the context. And of course, as practitioners who do this on a daily basis, that's probably where I can contribute the most in any case. So to begin with, I think following Prasanna's lead, when we talk about the language and definitions itself, I do actually agree with him that restricting a single tranche is probably not a good idea, even though we don't actually see it. But beyond that, we also feel having a reference to an SPV as part of the definition would be quite useful, because as it so happens, and we were discussing this separately as well, we do already have products like the pooled bond issuance where we have credit tranching, but it's not actually through a securitization structure. And those kind of innovative products, we don't want them to be treated as securitization. That's one thing. But secondly, on the flip side, we also want flexibility on the side of securitization to have flatter structures. So that's one of the points that we've talked about. And second point, which actually also had been alluded to before, but I want to bring out the fact that as NBFCs, we often get slightly we are in a slightly more difficult position compared to banks, simply because the regulatory framework is not completely aligned. And when we talk about risk weightage for banks versus risk weightage for BFCs, the number of 12-15 cases of something not complying with the regulations effectively means that we have to maintain twice the amount of capital in case of an NBFC. That's actually a function of the fact that we have to maintain higher capital adequacy in general compared to banks. So there are two points over there. One is, of course, we would hope that RBI will clarify that what is 1250 for banks has a corresponding figure for NBFCs. But also, as part of the drafting process, we would definitely like to see an NBFC is not, in a sense, being an afterthought which has to be corrected in the feedback session. But given that over the last few years, RBI has itself been much more comfortable with NBFCs, and we have the systemically important NBFCs, which are recognized as being important for the country as a whole to reach its financial inclusion goals, I think that will definitely help. And the idea of periodic review, which both Dr. Harshvardhan and Prasanna spoke about, I think is quite full. RBI already has a mechanism for doing this as part of its master circular program. And I think this should be part of that, because both in terms of complexity as well as in terms of dynamism, I think it's important that people keep their finger on the pulse for the securitization market. There will be changes required in future, both protective changes as well as enabling changes. And it's by its very nature, it's a market which needs to have some innovation. But at the same time, we need to ensure that whatever is being permitted and whatever is being promoted is appropriate. So for instance, as a matter of principle, I do not have a problem with the securitization of securitized assets. As someone who does this on a day-to-day basis, and we deal with investors and originators, I do feel it would probably be premature for us to be focusing on something like that. It's a very powerful tool, but it's not for us right now. And so, I mean, I think having an evolutionary process is probably the best way to go. And we have a very strong bedrock. So we are talking about the feedback that is being sought for this particular set of draft guidelines. But I think we have an over a 20-year period, or even more than that, a history of thinking of securitization for this purpose. So we have a lot to build on, and we should continue doing that. Okay, so getting to some more of the commercial aspects, we've talked about how assets originated by corporates are not eligible, and the guidelines kind of make it very penal for banks or NBFCs to invest in securitization that has been originated by corporates. And we think that that's not necessarily ideal, because in a sense, if it's receivables from a particular set of people, and for instance, there may be an example of a company which rents out furniture, and in that case, the actual cash flows are retail assets, and they actually meet the STC criteria in terms of predictability, in terms of homogeneity, in terms of being a very large number of small cases. And there is actually a mechanism by which an investor can analyze the credit profile of those customers. And in fact, it's a feedback loop. So we can actually influence the way the corporate finds customers and enters into leases with customers to address any credit concerns that we have. So we would definitely prefer that financial, it's not that the prudential norm should not be followed. It's just that as an investor, the prudential norm should apply to the investor rather than prohibiting a corporate from actually having a securitization transaction. Another point that we've talked about is what happens if there is a non-compliance with the guidelines. I think the fundamental principle should be that if there is non-compliance, firstly, there are two types of non-compliance, which is firstly the non-compliance which relates to true sale or derecognition. And in those cases, the consequence should be limited to a capital charge, no more penal than it would have been had the asset actually been transferred. And I think Dr. Harshvardhan had specifically referred to that as well. And I think that's an important design principle to have. And the second thing is where it is a breach of the regulation, and I'm actually talking about breach because sometimes we may think that it's compliant, but someone else may think it's a breach, right? So even in those cases, if it is not relating to true sale or derecognition, there should be proportionate consequences. If everything leads to reversing derecognition, there are two problems with it. One is it's very difficult for accountants to actually be confident, because they're like, okay, you know what? Unless I get a clarification from this list of 15 people, I cannot derecognize. That is one. And secondly, it also creates uncertainty in the minds of investors as well. So it's good to say, I mean, derecognition should not be it should be limited to cases where it's actually something that the risk has not transferred or the asset has not transferred. And this has become difficult for NBFCs as opposed to banks, because India's the view seems to be that if the first loss is not transferred fully, then or if any more than the first loss is transferred in that sense, then the asset is not derecognized. Sorry, I'm saying it wrong. But basically, if the first loss is still maintained by the originator, then it's not treated as being transferred. While actually misleading, even though the likelihood of losing that amount is much higher, and therefore it's, to my mind, it's an income recognition question rather than a derecognition question. But as a consequence, even though you can actually lose only 5%, you have to take a capital charge for 100%, which is actually misleading accounting. But that's how it is, and it's an important point that has to be addressed. This is really more India's rather than these guidelines, but these are all very closely connected, and we spoke about how taxation, accounting, and a lot of other laws are closely related to this. Another point I want to talk about, I think I'll take the opportunity, even though this wasn't part of our original list, is we've had a discussion in the chat as well as otherwise about what happens to the first loss, which is placed as cash. And I think this is one of those cases where the primary reason we have not been able to have the cash in the name of the trustee is income tax. And if the trustee needs to file an income tax return for the interest income which is being generated on that FD, that is a problem. Also, commercially, the interest income normally goes to the originator, even though the cash as a fixed sum is kept with the trust. And this is understandably causing some amount of confusion, but I think the thing to recognize is that the problem is actually primarily a taxation related issue. And if we can resolve that, I think people would be far more comfortable saying that commercially we want the money to be in the name of the trust and work on that. There are, of course, I'm going through a few points from a long list of over 40 items that we're giving inputs on formally to the RBI, just to give a sense of what kind of things we are concerned with. So far I've kind of talked about things that we've already mentioned, but I'm now bringing up a point which is, it's in that sense purely technical from a design perspective, is EIS triggers. And the current proposal is to say that the trigger should not be related to the performance of the underlying. While in fact, commercially, all the transactions that we've done, the triggers are only related to that. There's nothing else which is used as a trigger. And again, this, I think, even though I'm not 100% certain about this, but I think what RBI's intent over here is to say that, okay, it's income recognition, right? In the sense you're saying that you have this money that you're expecting to come in, but there are so many uncertainties which can cause that money to stop coming in. My only submission to RBI would be that while the concern is very valid, I think the way to address it is not to prohibit it, but to say that identify these four items and let this influence how you record this in your books, so that it's not misleading. The regulator understands what risk is actually being carried by those books, and everyone is clear that this is not money that is necessarily coming in. This is money that can actually be used as credit enhancement for the structure. I think there are a couple of other points which I mean, there'll be one other point rather that I had planned to cover, which is the discussion on whether bonds are assets. In the earlier, the current guidelines, the currently effective guidelines, we clearly had an explanatory statement saying that bonds are part of the assets. That has been removed. We feel it is important for bonds to continue to be part of the definition of assets. There are a couple of reasons for that. Firstly, I alluded to the fact that we already have a product where bonds are packaged, even though it's not a securitization product, but it is something that could be packaged as securitization and it would be useful. Secondly, it actually enables us to have a mix of loans as well as debentures so that we can design a transaction which meets the risk profile of an investor. And that's really what we do for a living. And that's really why investors are interested, whether it's mutual funds, anyone. The reason why they are interested in securitization is because they can actually say that, okay, I want a transaction which has these features. And it is actually possible for people like us to offer them something which is tailored to what they want. So I think with that, I'll stop. I think the questions are going to be more interesting to me than specifically the points of feedback, because we've been going through this for the last couple of weeks in detail. And what I am really keen to hear is what kind of questions people have and what the other panelists have to say with respect to those questions. And of course, if there are any questions I can answer, I'd be happy to do that. Thank you.
So thank you very much, Saurabh. Yes, Dr. Bardhan, you wanted to come in about
So there are two points I'd like to make. Let me quickly make the point about the definition. But me, actually, single tranche is like a contradiction in term. It's like a DA. If you are saying that I'm just creating one tranche, and you effectively are selling the underlying loan pool to one entity, which is exactly what a DA is. Maybe the difference is you create a tradable paper in between. I think the spirit of securitization is, and as Saurabh said, I don't think anybody will view single tranche securitization as securitization. Purely technically, there is no reason why it should not be allowed. I don't see necessarily much of a market for that. But let me come to the bankruptcy remote point of view. I think it's a very important issue. It goes to the heart of securitization, because without this provision, the transaction may not take off. And there are a set of legal issues which are beyond RBI's remit. And I don't think the RBI guidelines can do much about it. And the one issue is the transaction, and Saurabh can come in here for sure. The transaction, the way that they have, that the originator assigns the future receivables from the asset pool to the trust. The security interest is never transferred. And it's not transferred because, Saurabh, correct me if I'm wrong, that there are stamp duty registration kind of issues that come in if you were to transfer the underlying security. Now this creates a problem. Therefore, the underlying loan contract and underlying security interest resides with the originator even after the pool receivables have been assigned, which means that two things happened. If the security, the trust has to enforce security interest as in a SARFAESI situation, it cannot, because it does not have that interest. And secondly, it makes it much harder to make the vehicle bankruptcy remote. I think the issue with credit enhancement is one step further, because it's a deposit in the name of the originator. So you can get escrow, etc. around it, but it's still not bankruptcy proof. So my view has always been that on the one hand, you can simplify a stamp duty registration requirement so that there is economic incentive to transfer the security interest so that it gets solved here, or else explicitly provide for this in a bankruptcy law, because I don't think there is any other fix possible on this one.
And just quickly a couple of points. I think what you're describing, there's clearly a distinction between immovable property and a mobile property. Yeah.
But basically, demarcated that is considered movable, immovable property, right?
Yes, yes.
So they have to attract registration, yeah.
Correct. So that, unfortunately, because of stamp duty, registration, everyone is involved. The center is involved, states are involved, and multiple taxation authorities are involved. As a consequence, this is something that was identified very early, maybe about 25 years ago, when the first white papers on securitization came in. But it is not something that we've been able to fix. So that is definitely something that, for instance, the bankruptcy code could address parts of it, and that would be quite useful. But yes, that remains a challenge for mortgage-backed securitization. There are structures that some people are comfortable with, but the level of comfort that people have even in those structures is far from ideal. And there are some states where it's easier, some states where it's not. For movable properties, it is a little bit easier. In fact, there's a provision of law which actually says that if the asset is transferred, the underlying security will also automatically get transferred. Yeah, so that's quite helpful. And this is a very old law, so it's in a sense, we sometimes feel that securitization is a new instrument. But I think the idea of credit being a tradable commodity is many hundreds of years old. And I guess in some ways, India was part of that market even before the West was. And specifically talking about where we have first loss, I saw a comment somewhere that the first loss should always be the property of the trust in the case of cash deposit. And I kind of agree with that. Like I said, there are commercial reasons why that's difficult to do. In addition, there are certain types of first loss or second loss which are not fund-based. So I mean, they're popularly called guarantees, even though they're not actually guarantees because there's no reference obligation, but they are contingent liabilities placed on whoever is providing that. Technically, this could be the originator or it could even be a third party. In that case, you can actually have a contingent liability which is secured by a cash deposit or by any other asset, and in which case it actually does become a security and is not in not part of the pool of assets that the trust has. Yeah, correct.
My general principle here, I think, ought to be that any enhancement, you should be very flexible on the mode of enhancement. So you don't want to do regulation assuming that the enhancement will always come in form of cash, because as the market develop, it may not. And therefore, other forms of enhancements, including first loss, could come through.
And yes. So what we've seen commercially is that a lot of this depends on exactly who the originator is, where you have AA or AAA rated originators, which we have actually done. In those cases, people are quite comfortable with
their own guarantees.
Yes. But in most of the transactions that we do, because we deal with smaller originators, that's not going to work and we need to actually have cash.
Yeah, that to my mind also signifies a little bit immaturity of the market, that historically it has been done by lower rated companies and sold to higher rated companies, and hence this issue comes that you need a cash sort of if you take a 10-20 year view, I mean, this could be a liquidity management tool for the highest rated companies, in which case you need to allow a non-cash form of even first loss enhancement.
Yes. In fact, that's a very interesting point, because the regulations have even earlier independently talked about liquidity support as very distinct from credit support, but we don't actually see liquidity support as an independent commercial input
activity.
Normally it's designed into the product itself. That's a function of partly of the asset classes we focus on. I'm sure for other asset classes where there is more uncertainty around timing but greater certainty around the cash flow coming in, a liquidity facility would be useful. But in most of our asset classes, we know that if money hasn't come for 6 months from a particular loan, it's less likely that it will come within the life of the transaction, which is, let's say, 2 years. So we have those kind of benchmarks which make it difficult to say that we are only treating this as a liquidity problem and not a credit problem. But I think what you said about whether then from a long-term perspective, first loss should be treated one way or the other. I think you're right when you said earlier that we should be talking about how bankruptcy law should look at things like this. And but I feel that while that is true, I would still prefer a structural thing to say that, okay, if the money is part of the assets of the trust, let's transfer it. And let's make sure that it's not onerous from a tax perspective, from an accounting perspective, from a consolidation perspective. We don't want trustees to freak out saying that, okay, now this is becoming onerous for me. But again, this is not necessarily something RBI can do something about. And
okay. We have a lot of questions flowing in. I don't think we'll be able to handle all of them in the allotted time. May I take the opportunity to put two questions together and make it open to the panelists to respond to that. Question number one, which is something like suggesting how much of substantive difference, I mean, the suggestion comes out of a concept. How much of substantive difference could there be between securitization of single asset and a loan syndication of a single exposure from the ALM perspective? That is one thing. So whether the RBI guidelines should have made some, thrown some light on this or clarified that part of it. The other question is, with reference to the single tranche, transactions. So the participant is asking, what's the difference between a single tranche, single asset securitization and a direct sale of a single asset, ultimately?
So Mr. Panda, that's exactly the point I made when I spoke about 5 minutes ago, which is that for me, there is no difference. I mean, the only conceivable difference is instead of selling the loan, you are creating a security in between a paper, theoretically tradable, and issuing that to the one single investor. So in the underlying economics, I think it's exactly the same. And that's why I just don't see that to be a significant point. In terms of the syndication versus securitization, my view is that in a syndication, the assets still reside balance sheet of an institution, which will have ALM problem. I mean, imagine you have a 15-year infrastructure asset. Your average deposit maturity is 2.5 years. You still have an ALM problem. It's just that the problem is now divided across seven different institutions. Versus if you had the same assets and securities created which are bought by, let's say, an insurance company or a pension fund, then the originating institution end up holding a fraction, the MRR, let's say, of that that asset, 10%. And so its ALM problem will come down to that extent. So I don't think the syndication resolves the ALM problem. Securitization can.
Okay. One more question to Dr. Bardhan specifically. So what it says is the securitization framework has provided relaxation with respect to MHP in case of mortgage loans, which is missing in sale of loan framework. I mean, loan exposure.
Well, two things.
The intention
not a part
to
of the sale of loan committee. No.
The question is the intention is it showing the intention of the regulator or whatever? Disincentivize PA of mortgage loans and incentivize RMBS.
I have absolutely no insight into the intentions of the regulator. I'll also say that I was not involved in the other committee, so I don't know what the thinking there was on the loan of sale sale of loan committee. In securitization, we had explicitly said that the 6 month or six installment should be made permanent, which they have done.
One more question, which is broad but very current matter of current concern. What the participant is saying is that there has been a lot of instances of fraud, corporate frauds, and also the frauds in the mortgage loans. In that, against that backdrop, how do we control that the originators do not do multiple securitization transactions with same underlying borrowers, which means that whether the regulation should address this?
Yeah, I mean, to me, fraud is a crime, is a law enforcement issue, it's not a regulatory issue.
I can actually, I can talk slightly about
frauds. Yeah.
Yeah, I can talk about how we try and mitigate that risk. One of the things that we do actually do is check the systems of the originator. We are familiar with the kinds of systems used by NBFCs to record their assets and how they flag assets as being either hypothecated to someone or being transferred to someone. And we have periodic, which is to say once in 3 months or once in 6 months, visits to people's head offices, where we actually test this on a sample basis, of course. But yes, there is a residual risk which remains, but I think there are reasonable ways of testing this statistically, which people can and should definitely do. I think it's definitely a good practice to do this. And like Dr. Harshvardhan said, that some of it is a law and order problem. You cannot actually prevent people from stealing money and running away. You just have to hope that most people are not thieves and make a provision for 0.1% of people to try and steal from you. It's like that.
So yet another comment or question, you may say so, is about the risk weight. The transactions arising out of outside this framework, the higher capital, the risk weight and consequential capital. So not in preclude the banks and NBFCs from investing in such transactions, whether the
I think that is clear. And the 1250 risk weight there is, so effectively what the RBI is saying, and I think I totally agree with it, is that if there is a transactions, for example, if people are doing trade receivable securitization, which is not covered under the RBI guide, very risky transaction as per the view of the RBI. And so they would rather banks treat it like the riskiest of equity type of investment for which there is 1250% risk weight. So I think that the underlying, what the regulator is saying, that we have defined a certain kind of transaction securitization, which we are comfortable with for the regular entities we regulate to invest in. Anything outside of that, there is no comfort with the risk. So we will treat it like any other very high risk instruments and properties. I think it's very consistent in terms of the broader approach of. So for those transactions, either people will have to have non-regulated investors, so sort of non-NBFCs, non-banks, or live with the fact that it will attract higher risk weights.
Having implication about the capital relief, that is, it is applying retrospectively. So there is no grandfathering clause in this. So what's the take of the panelists on this?
To me, honestly, this is an empirical question to how to what extent we have already outstanding PTCs and how will they be impacted. I mean, I don't think there is it would be nice if it was prospectively, but I don't know retrospectively how many transactions actually get factually impacted. Maybe Saurabh might have a better sense, but.
Unfortunately, I don't have numbers I can give you on this, but yes, anytime there is a retrospective change in the way our assets are going to be recognized, that will be something that is a matter of concern. Given the timelines of our assets and given how dynamic the market is for us individually, I think we can probably manage any adverse impact that this would have as a proactive thing, but it would probably, a grandfathering provision is probably something that they should have allowed, and that's what we will ask for as well.
So I think, Mr. Panda, let me just come in for a minute here. This is one of the points that I couldn't finish in my earlier talk, which is that the grandfathering has not been done. So, I mean, there is a bit of history to it. And what had happened was a lot of discussion was happening between RBI and banks. And finally, it was as early as in March 2020, which is when RBI said that, okay, you can really go ahead and even though Ind AS does not really recognize certain types of securitization, you can really go ahead and not provide capital on it with a 0% risk weightage. Now, this guideline, when it now gets implemented, will actually unwind this notification which RBI had given in March, which basically will lead to investors like banks and NBFCs who follow RBI guidelines to provide capital on not only the credit enhancement which is appearing in the originated loans, originated and securitized loans, but also on the loans which have actually been given off the balance sheet. So I think, Saurav said, we will be writing in our feedback to RBI to say that these guidelines cannot be made, retrospective. It will definitely affect all the investors who have actually picked up positions in this securitized asset. And just one clarification I wanted to give on the earlier point on the tranching. So when I talked about tranching, I did not really talk about a single investor. It was more about single tranche, in the sense that we ourselves have invested in multiple, there have been multiple loans in the underlying, which have then been credit enhanced and then converted into a PTC, securitized and sold to us. And we would be the only investor, and there would be only one tranche in that. There is no junior, senior, and mezzanine, so to speak. So I think that was the difference that I was trying to bring out, not necessarily the direct assignment or a single investor thing. I mean, I meant single tranche, which basically means that there is no junior or a mezzanine tranche in that particular securitization transaction. And the other difference is the fact that, I think that was the main point.
Okay. Anybody from the participants have a question which can be straight away asked? We are almost coming to a close.
Sir, if I have time, can I just finish with 2 minutes of what I couldn't say earlier, if there is no other person wanting to talk?
Yeah, we just have only 2 minutes, so you can take 1 minute, then we'll wrap up in another 1 minute.
Okay, this is relating to the guidelines, which itself has asked questions on uniform valuation and listing. So the suggestion which we wanted to give is that uniform valuation of corporate bonds has actually not seen the light of day, because every investor has his own business model and has different types of valuation methodologies. So I somehow think that that is not the road that we need to travel at this point of time to insist it be uniform valuation. There are bigger battles to fight. Maybe we should fight that battle, develop the market, and then come to this much later, because even in corporate bonds, it has actually failed. On the listing part, I wanted to say that it is better not to mandatorily give any listing requirement. Let the originator decide, because there are certain segments of the market which can buy only listed debt. There are certain segments which can buy even unlisted PTCs. Let the originator decide whether he has the benefit of the enhanced investor base if he gets listing, because there are additional costs, additional timelines involved in getting a PTC listed. What we should instead do is the same thing that a listing tries to achieve, is to get greater transparency and greater disclosure. We should ensure that a lot of granular data which is coming out of the rating agencies who are underwriting, who are rating the pool, they should come out with much more data about how the performance of the various pool is with very frequent intervals, to ensure that the transparency and the disclosure part is taken care of. I don't think we should make listing mandatory. These were the 2 points.
So, hello. Hello, am I audible?
Yes.
There's a last question, very practical, tiny question, but I think it's interesting. Somebody is asking, will the special mention account 00+ be considered under this framework, or under the framework of sale of stressed assets?
So this is Harsh. My view is that this framework applies to standard assets. SMAs are not standard assets, so they should not apply. Although I'm not the best expert on this. Sinha sir might have a view.
Mr. Sinha should.
No, actually, I would stick with what you are saying. You know, we are trying to fix maybe 97-98% of, you know, these are, you know, things which will get evolved over time. You know, we are getting into the, you know, the last 2%, 1% issues are not worthwhile, you know, for a market which is not really got going. So stick with standard, have confidence, over time things will change.
I also have another point over there. I think in terms of SMA status being accessible to everybody, I think there is still some, not all investor classes may have access to the same information. And I think that is, that's a distortion in the market that should be addressed as well.
If I think that gets fixed when we have a separate, you know, the RBI has been planning a separate, you know, credit kind of repository. So then it will be possible. Under the current law, it's not possible, you know, because it's a, so that you are aware of, being a legal person.
So no, we've given that feedback before, and I think that's been taken seriously, and there are steps being taken for that.
That's right.
Would it have been better, or is it a fact that the RBI guidelines have not addressed the issue of co-mingling risk and securitization transactions, which is very, very critical and often ignored part of it, both during transaction by the practitioners and also by the regulators?
As a practitioner, I must embarrassingly admit that I think it is, given the modern technology and the processes being followed, commercially parties can do a lot better. And this, so even though this it could be possible for regulations to impose this, I frankly feel that it is something that the market should also introspect about. We allow 1 month to 45 days. We should be able to do it in less than a week, frankly.
My view is exactly the same, that I think the regulation should not get into detailed commercial process issues. This is what the, between the trust and the originator and the intermediary, they should figure this out. I think there are easy technological solutions to deal with commingling and so on. It's not a regulatory issue.
So, okay, we have just made 90 minutes. So this is the end of it.